அது மல்லி மினிமம் 4 லட்சம் அது
மூர்த்தி மூர்த்திகார் ராதா ఇచ్చేసాగారు ఫోన్ లో మాట్లాడతా ఎప్పుడు రేపు సాయంత్రం ఉన్నా రేపు పొద్దున్న కాకినాడ చేస్తాం సార్ కళ్యాణ్ వచ్చాడు కదా సాయంత్రం ఆయన రేపు రేపు వస్తున్నా రేపు అది అది రమ్మన్నారు
హలో సార్ కాన్ఫరెన్స్ హాల్లో ఉన్నాం సార్ మీటింగ్ స్టార్ట్ అయిపోయింది
నేను ఎక్కడ ఉంటాను అయితే
అప్పుడే మీటింగ్ అయిపోయింది
స్టార్ట్ అయిపోయింది కదా అనుకోండి స్టార్ట్ అయిపోయింది
పదిన్నర రిపేర్ తయారు చేసుకుంటున్నప్పుడు మనం కనిపిస్తాం కదా అనేక మనసు వస్తుంటారు
ఇక్కడ ఇక్కడ
వస్తుంది
ఇక్కడ రావాలా
దీన్ని చెప్తే
అదే కదా అలా కాదు కదా, మనం ఓపెన్ చేసినప్పుడు మనం స్టార్ట్ వీడియో మన వీడియో రావాలి కదా. ఓకే
అన్న అదిరీ అన్న
అన్నా
ఒకటి ఒక టైం ఒక జోబులు కూడా తిరుగుతూ ఉండాలా
సార్? అన్మ్యూట్ చేయండి
సార్. అన్మ్యూట్ చేసాను
కదా. చేశాను చేశాను.
ఇక్కడ కే రామరాజన్ ఉందా? ఇక్కడ పేరు మరదు ప్రస్తుతానికి.
ఏంటి సముద్రం వెనక సముద్రం వెనక పెట్టారు నాకు.
నెట్వర్క్ వైఫై వస్తుంది. కాఫీ పెట్టమని పెట్టా
సార్. మ్యూట్ అయినప్పుడు ఎవరికల్లా అన్మ్యూట్ చేసుకుంటున్నా?
మా నలుగురికి మాత్రం ఆ అవకాశం ఇవ్వు.
అది రావట్లేదు సార్, ఇక్కడ ఆప్షన్ చూపించట్లేదు సార్. అందుకనే
స్వరూప్
సార్ చెప్పండి సార్.
ఈ స్క్రీన్ మీద అది వచ్చిన తర్వాత కింద నా ఫోటో రావట్లేదండి.
మీ ఫోటోనా సార్?
వీడియో పెట్టుకున్నప్పుడు రావాలి కదా. బొమ్మ వస్తుంది, బొమ్మ ఎవరు ఇక్కడ?
సార్ మీది వస్తుంది సార్?
ఇక్కడ నా స్క్రీన్ లో రావట్లేదండి. పైన ఇప్పుడు నువ్వు వచ్చావు, ఇప్పుడు ఇమానుల్ గారు వచ్చాడు కింద. అక్కడ వస్తుందిలే, డ్రాక్ చేస్తే వస్తుందిలే. ఇక్కడ వస్తాను. వెళ్ళాడా దివాకర్ ఫోన్ చేశాడా మన?
ఓకే
ఓకే.
సార్
రామగారు ఏసీమా
సార్?
ఫిజిక్స్
నా రెండు ఉన్నాయండి.
మీరు సపోజ్ ఇక్కడ లేదు సార్, మీరు తెచ్చు కాదు, ఇక్కడ సంబంధం లేదు, త్వరగా ఎవరైనా చెప్తారు సార్ ఎవరు తెలియదు.
చేస్తేనే అసలు ఆయన కూడా సమ్మానం చేసి సరిపోవటం. మైండ్లీ ఏర్పాటు చేసిన సార్ ప్రోగ్రామ్, లైట్ గిట్ పెట్టేసారు, కెమెరా సెట్టింగ్
చేశారు అప్పుడు మాత్రం అసలు లాభలే థియేటర్ లాగా ఉండేది అది. మామూలుగా ప్రేరణ చెప్తుంటే ఇలా ల్యాప్టాప్ ఎదురుగా పెట్టుకొని మామూలు కూర్చొని చూడగానీ ల్యాప్టాప్ కంప్యూటర్ నాకు అసలు అయ్యో అర్థం
కాదు. రెండున్నర వరకు మీటింగ్ అయ్యే వరకు ఏం మాట్లాడినా
గారు బీజీ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ లో ఆయన ఏదో వర్క్ లో ఉన్నాడు. ఆయన ఫోన్ ఫోన్ నెంబర్ లేదు. 05 605 మొత్తం 5 మంది. ఏం కనిపిస్తుంది ఏం రసం?
10 20
100 ఇంక చూడాలి మాస్టారు. 100
నేను ఎక్స్పెక్ట్ చేయట్లే.
ఇప్పుడు 5 మంది నువ్వు ఈతో పాటు 6.
అదేంటది
అదేంటండి అంతే ఉంటదండి.
మీటింగ్ ఐడి
వచ్చిన
తర్వాత ఇప్పుడు మా అమ్మాయి సిస్టమ్ లో ప్రాబ్లం ఏమొస్తుందంటే ఉన్నట్టు స్టక్
అలా
కాకుండా నేను జియో మోడెమ్ పెట్టాను పక్కన వైఫై పెడతాను. సమస్య మిస్ అయిపోతుంది ఆటోమేటిక్
రాసుకు
చెప్తాను.
మీ ఫోన్ పేలో వెళ్ళండి సార్.
ఫోన్ పే కాదు, గూగుల్
02
సార్
1999 అక్కడ ఉంటా సార్. చూడండి
ఫోన్ ఉంటుంది
సార్, ఫోన్ పే నా కాదు.
ఏంటన్నా
మొబైల్ రీఛార్జ్
ఉన్నారు నవీన్ చెప్పారు సార్
ఈ నెంబర్
ఏ ఇమాన్యుయల్ సార్ కరస్పాండెంట్ గారు వచ్చారండి నవీన్ ఒకసారి ఇలా ఫోన్ లో ఆన్ చేయమను ఆ మెటీరియల్ కూడా అక్కడ ఉంది ఇమ్మను
హలో నమస్తే అవునండి వాట్సాప్ పంపించిన
శ్రీనివాస్ గారు మాట్లాడితే మొత్తం దీంట్లో రికార్డ్ అవుతుంది మీరు ఫోన్ మాట్లాడాలంటే బయట లేదు మాట ఫోన్ మాట్లాడాలంటే బయటకి వెళ్ళి మాట్లాడండి ఇది రికార్డ్ అవుతుంది కదా మీ వాయిస్ కూడా ఇది అవుతుంది
పదహారు మంది వచ్చారు సార్ అంటే ఇప్పుడు మనం పెరిగి పెట్టుకుంటున్నాం స్టార్టింగ్ ప్లేస్ ఒకటి స్టార్టింగ్
సార్
ఇప్పుడు కరెక్ట్ గా 10:30 స్టార్ట్ చేద్దామా లేదా వెయిట్ చేద్దామా
ఒక 5 నిమిషాలు వెయిట్ చేద్దాం అన్న 16 మంది వచ్చారు
16 నాకు 5 మంది కనబడుతున్నారు
అరే స్వరూప్ జాయిన్ చేస్తున్నాడు
అదే అదే పాదం తీసుకొచ్చాడు పెట్టాను నేను
అదే
అలాగే పెట్టలేక సార్ అప్పుడు కాఫీ రాదు ఇప్పుడు వచ్చిందండి అదే కమిషనర్ కి
అందరిని మీట్ చేసాం మనం
ఈయన కూడా డైరెక్ట్ గా పార్టీకే పంపారు మీరు అప్పుడు బానే అన్నారు మనం నేను కమిషనర్ పంపాలి కదా అన్నాను కదా కాదు మీరు డైరెక్ట్ గా పార్టీకే అన్నారు కదా
సార్ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్, కరుణాకర్ గారు గుడ్ మార్నింగ్.
అన్మ్యూట్ చేయమ్మా.
ఎవరు సార్?
కరుణాకర్ గారు.
హలో.
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్.
గుడ్
మార్నింగ్. ఈజ్ దివాకర్ పాల్ దివాకర్, ఆర్గనైజింగ్ సెక్రటరీ, హెడ్ ఆఫ్ ద డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఫిజిక్స్. ఈజ్ మిస్టర్ మై ప్రిన్సిపాల్ డాక్టర్ కె రామరాజు గారు. దే ఆర్ కరుణాకర్ కొత్తపల్లి అండ్ ఫర్జానా నస్రీన్.
థ్యాంక్ యూ మేడం. గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్.
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్. గుడ్ మార్నింగ్. థ్యాంక్ యూ ఫర్ హావింగ్ అస్. Also, we have no power here, electricity, because of heavy rain last evening.
Okay.
So we have to share the computer because only one computer has battery. We saved one computer with full battery, one we used. Okay. So if we run out of battery, we will let you know.
Okay. Then after, because you know, it is about 2.5 hours program. The madam program will be around, I think it is around 12:15 to 1 o'clock.
Okay.
So have you got the program sheet?
Yeah, I have the program sheet. Pamu sent it to me on my phone.
Okay, very good, very good. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So almost the program will go like that only, sir. A little bit of 5 to 10 minutes delay because of the weather here also is not that much correct.
Okay.
So therefore, it will be a little bit. We are already in late, I think.
No, we started right time. It's 10:30. Yeah, we are.
Yeah, but even then, many our participants have to join.
Okay.
Therefore,
okay.
A little bit of delay may be there.
Okay.
Kindly bear with us.
Yeah, no problem. No problem. Just to save phone's computer's battery, shall we rejoin in like 10 minutes? Because we only have one computer with battery. Can I rejoin in like 5-10 minutes? If I use video less, it will save the battery.
Yeah.
I will come back in 10 minutes to save the battery.
Okay.
అది రావట్లేదు.
ఈ ఫోటో మ్యూట్ లో పెట్టుంటారు సార్ వీడియో.
అక్కడ
ఐ థింక్
అప్పుడు గారు జాయిన్ అయ్యారు అన్న.
ఐ థింక్ బ్రదర్ జయప్రకాష్ గారు ఇస్ ఆల్సో ఆన్ ద లైన్. ఐ థింక్ ఇఫ్ ఇట్ ఇస్ పాసిబుల్ కెన్ వి సే
నేనేం చేశానంటే
ఎప్పుడు మాట్లాడాలో చెప్తే అప్పుడు ఇస్తా. నా దగ్గర పెట్టుకున్నా
దివాకర్ సార్. దివాకర్ సార్ దివాకర్ సార్
అన్నా చెప్పనా.
Can we start the program by 10:40?
Okay, 10:40.
Because our secretary sir and correspondent sir is already there in the line. Most probably they may have some programs, urgent programs.
We have to start by 10:40.
10:40. Start. Excuse me, all of you, because of technical problem, we are going to start our program by 10:40. Please bear with us.
స్వరూప్ ఎంతమంది అయ్యారు? 50ఆ?
వస్తున్నారా
ఇమాన్యుయల్ సార్?
యా
డాక్టర్ ఇమాన్. సో వి ఆర్ బ్యాక్.
ఓకే ఓకే.
సో డాక్టర్ దివాకర్,
యా
యా ప్లీజ్ స్టార్ట్ ద ప్రోగ్రామ్. నౌ ఇట్ ఇస్ 10:40.
అసలు డైరెక్ట్ ఎక్కడ
పోతుంది? స్టార్ట్ ద ప్రోగ్రామ్ సార్.
యా యా
Emmanuel sir, you start the program.
Yeah. No, no, actually please start with our AV.
Swaroop.
వాళ్ళు మ్యూట్ చేసేస్తారు.
So, good morning to you all. I'm introducing myself, Dr. K. Emmanuel, Professor of Chemistry and Vice Principal of Sir CRD College. It's a great privilege for me to stand before you on behalf of the prestigious college, which is celebrating its Platinum Jubilee year. And I welcome you for the two-day international webinar on Materials and Environmental Sciences. Materials and Environmental Sciences are the multidisciplinary of materials and environmental science of all academic fields. It is a natural cycle but accelerated process. These phenomena involve qualitative and quantitative estimations and take wide parts of the environment. Material science reports on current research into such problems as cracking, fatigue and fracture, especially in active environments, as well as corrosion and anti-corrosion production of structural, metallic and polymer materials and the development of new materials. Our management has very generous to encourage us to conduct such type of online webinars. And first of all, I would like to thank my management members for giving me the opportunity to conduct this type of webinars. When we approached the professors like D. Pamu, IIT Guwahati, Professor Karunakar Kottapalli from Ting University, USA, Professor Farzana Nasreen from US, Jayaprakash, Professor IIT Roorkela, and Dr. Tarun Dolla from IIT Guwahati, they have gladly accepted to address the gathering. Now, I would like to introduce our president, Sir CRD Education Institution, Sri Allur Indra Kumar, who is an industrialist and philanthropist. And he is very generous in this pandemic corona time. He has generously donated crores of rupees to the PM Relief Fund and as well as the CM relief funds of both Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Now, I'm very glad to introduce Dr. MBSB Prasad Garu, MS Artho, Secretary Sir CRD Education Institutions, who has done exemplary service in various fields, including Red Cross and Thalassemia people. Now, I have a joy to introduce Dr. K.S. Vishnumohan Garu, MS Artho, correspondent, Sir CRD College, who has done human service to the society. I am glad to introduce the young and dynamic personality, Sri K. Sivaramakrishna Prasad, correspondent, Sir CRD College PG courses. I wish to introduce my beloved principal, Dr. K. Ramaraj Garu, who is a a good academician and a researcher. Now, I am glad to introduce Sri LSRCH Nageswar Rao Garu, is presently a PG director. Now, I am also very glad to introduce Dr. P. Paul Divakar Garu, HOD Physics and coordinator of IPSC NAC and also organizing secretary for this international webinar, who is instrumental in arranging the two-day international webinar, sir. Now, the program starts with a prayer.
Hello.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our chief guest and our beloved secretary, Dr. MBS SP Prasad Garu, and also the correspondent K. Vishnu Mohan Garu, to light the lamp. So thank you very much, sir, for lighting the lamp. Now I would like to invite the president of today's program, Dr. K. Ramaraj Garu, to say the opening remarks of the webinar.
Thank you, ML Garu. Respected Secretary, Sir CRID Group of Institutions, Dr. MBSC Prasad Garu. Respected correspondent, CRID Autonomous College, Dr. K. Vishnu Mohan Garu. Respected Vice Principal of the College, Dr. K. M.I.L. Garu. Respected NAC Coordinator and Organizing Secretary of today's webinar, Dr. P. Paul Devakar Garu. Other distinguished members of the platform, resource persons, colleagues, friends and guests. Very good morning to all of you. It is my great pleasure to welcome you all to the inauguration event of the international webinar on materials and environmental sciences organized by the departments of physics and chemistry, both UG and PG. I would like to thank you for all of you for joining with us. Materials science is an interdisciplinary field involving the properties of matter and its applications to various areas of science and engineering. It includes elements of applied physics and chemistry, as well as chemical, mechanical, civil and electrical engineering. With the significant media attention to nanoscience and nanotechnology in the recent years, material science has been propelled to the forefront at many universities, sometimes controversially. In material science, rather than haphazardly looking for and discovering materials and exploiting their properties, one instead aims to understand materials fundamentally so that new materials with the desired properties can be created. The basis of all material science involves relating the desired properties and the relative performance of a material in a certain application to the structure of the atoms and phases in that material through characterization. Environmental science is a holistic and multidisciplinary field that integrates the biological, physical, and earth sciences. Its goal is to understand how Earth works and how it supports life. It also aims to identify control, and prevent disruption to its systems and species caused by human activity. So this webinar has been organized to discuss various issues related to material science, materials and environmental science. I hope you have an engaging and enriching session ahead. I once again congratulate the departments of physics and chemistry of both UG and PG for organizing this wonderful seminar in this lockdown period. I am thankful to our management. Thanking you once again, all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, I request the chief guest of today's function, our secretary, Dr. MBSP Prasad Garu, to give his valuable inaugural address, sir.
Good morning, everybody. I congratulate the organizers for organizing such a beautiful scientific seminar. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Welcome to all the resource persons and participants to this international webinar being conducted by our Sir CRD Autonomous College. It is my privilege to deliver inaugural address of this webinar on the topic, wonderful topic, it is materials and environmental sciences. These both are very important. Humans needs materials. At the same time, they have to protect themselves from the environmental hazards. Material science is an interdisciplinary field involving the properties of matter and its application to various areas of science and engineering. It includes elements of applied physics and chemistry, as well as chemical, mechanical, civil, and electrical engineering to understand ancient phenomenological observations in metallurgy and mineralogy. Material science is a syncretic discipline hybridizing metallurgy, ceramics, solid state physics, and chemistry. It is the first example of a new academic discipline emerging by fusion than by fission. Many of the most pressing scientific problems humans currently face are due to the limits of available materials and how they are used. Thus, breakthroughs in material science are likely to affect the future of technology significantly. It covers a variety of research areas, including nanotechnology, biomaterials, and metallurgy. Material science is also an important part of forensic engineering and failure analysis. This is very important. Investigating materials, products, structures, or components which fail or do not function as intended, causing personal injury or damage to property. Such investigations are key to the understanding, for example, the causes of various activation accidents and incidents. Recent LG polymers incidents is a very good example. At the same time, human well-being depends on the health of the ecosystem. An ecosystem is a dynamic complex of plants, animals, microorganisms, and their non-living environment, of which people are an integral part. The benefits that we derive from the nature and rely on every day on, from timber and food to water and climate regulations, are all ecosystem services. It is gratifying to note that the agenda of the webinar covers a wide range of very interesting items relating to the materials and environmental sciences. I wish the webinar be a successful and reach its goals as mentioned. I wish all the participants will enjoy the proceedings of the webinar during these 2 days. I congratulate the organizing departments, especially physics, Dr. Paul Devakar, and chemistry, Dr. K. Emmanuel, both UG and PG of our autonomous college, to select a good topic of present day need. Thank you very much for indeed. I am grateful to you for organizing on behalf of our institutes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your kind words. And with your encouragement, we will going to conduct this type of webinars in future also, sir. Thank you. Now, I request our correspondent, sir, Dr. K.S. Vishnumohan Garu, to greet the webinar, sir. Swaroop, please unmute your sir.
Sir, please unmute, sir.
Please unmute our correspondent. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Vinipistunda?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Vinipistunda kada?
Vinipistunda,
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good morning, one and all. I welcome all the delegates and I thank all the speakers for having readily accepted with our request to participate in our webinar. This is our college Platinum Jubilee year. These are the we are conducting series of webinars for the last few months. This is one among them about the importance and the need of the webinar of materials and environmental. Our predecessors have explained in detail, like our principal, our secretary explained about the program and importance of this webinar. So I don't want to take much of your time. I congratulate once again all the participants, and I hope they will be enriching their knowledge and refresh their knowledge with the talks we are going to hear ahead. So I congratulate for organizing this international webinar on environmental sciences and materials to our organizers like our principal, vice principal, Paul Divakar, and other participants, other members of our, this conference who are involved in this. So I request all the participants to have a patient hearing with the coming talks. So any inconvenience about the transmission and coverage, I regret if there is any. So I hope all the webinar will be a grand success, and I wish all the participants a happy and rich knowledge. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your encouraging words and practical words. Thank you very much, sir. Now, I'm inviting the important person, Dr. Pamugaru. He's a professor in physics department, IIT Guwahati, who is the instrumental in arranging the resource persons from in and around the world. Now, I invite Dr. Pamugaru, sir, a few words regarding the webinar. Yes. Sir, Dr. Pamu, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Please open your video, sir.
Yeah, because my bandwidth is low. If I use my video, probably you may not hear properly.
Yeah, okay, sir.
That is where I
We are unlucky to see your face, no?
Yes. See, because network connection is not so good here right now.
Yes, yes, sir. Please carry on, sir.
Yeah, good morning and warm welcome to all. And you have already heard a brief introduction about the webinar, the background of it from the management of the college and other esteemed guests. And thank you. I thank the organizers also for giving me this opportunity. And why we have particularly we are interested about this material science and the environmental. Now we are all realizing the importance of technology. It is not only a mere studies about a material or anything. Now we are experiencing the crux or the disasters related to the nature, what is happening with the environment, and also that the importance of material science or the technology in various things. You know, especially in this pandemic, we see that how it is important to understand technology, material science, not only in terms of medicine, in any other aspects of it we are looking at. And as we know that earlier when we talk about a material science, we used to think, okay, some physics people, some chemistry people, those who don't have any other job, they will go to university and do some material preparation and get some PhD and join in some college. That is what is the people's opinion earlier. But now we realize that the engineers, even if you look at most of the even technical departments, whether it is a computer science or electrical, electronics, mechanical, bio, anything. And people are after the material scientists. It's not that material scientists are great or anything, but Now, if you want to improve the technology and the performance of any device, you need to understand the materials to the core. Otherwise, we will not be able to understand, or you will not be able to do any technological developments in the country. And that is where we have planned about this thing. And also that, why the environmental science also linked to that is that if you use the materials diligently and the smart materials and smart technologies, actually you can save your environment because of the performance of the device. Earlier we know that any device, you see your TV used to consume a lot of power. Now we are talking about the 5-star electronics. What is the reason? Again, you are improving the performance of a device. As a result, you are able to save the electricity and the the heat that is generated by the device. Everything we are improving. So that is where it's important to understand the material of the core. And you will be listening to Professor Karnakar and Professor Farjana, the importance how deeply they study the materials to the core. You will be going to be listening. And I congratulate all the organizers for arranging this seminar, and also I thank all of you for giving this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And now it's a great joy for me to call upon Dr. Jayaprakash Garu, even though I have not given you much in advance, but please say best wishes to our webinar. And I am very delightful to introduce Mr. Jayaprakash. He is our old student of SDRD College, and now he did his PhD in Roorkela. He is working in as a chemistry professor in Roorkela. Please unmute.
Can you hear my voice?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Jayaprakash Garu.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
First of all, thank Dr. Emmanuel, sir, inviting me for this webinar and for my lecture also. And thing is that, Ms., I am very happy to give the lecture in our CRD College webinar. Since I am the old student, I studied my BSc 1996 to 1999. Since I know Ms., Dr. Emmanuel, sir, and Ramesh Raju, sir, and Paul Devkar, sir, in physics department, and Ramesh, and also our the present principal, sir. I know everybody that time.
Okay.
So I'm very happy to see you once again, and given an opportunity to present my research work. Right? And here, and also, Ms., I'm thankful to all the administration of CRIT College. Now, I'm very happy to see that that college, it become a more than university, developed so many courses, and very, very good, actually. I'm very happy to see that one. And I'm just want to give you only a few words about today's webinar. Thing is that this material science includes the chemistry, physics, biology, everything is very important. If you see everywhere in all the IITs, NITs, or abroad also, all the universities know they are doing research as a multidisciplinary. So it is not a basic, basic science, doing very few, but the interdisciplinary, which final goal is that to have an application of day-to-day life, means the materials actually. So that's why what happened is that when our DST also, they are encouraging all the researchers in India having a multidisciplinary research, including a final some material should have a direct application. It's very important. Why? Because if you see carefully, the China, South Korea, Japan, why technologically they are so much developed is because of long back onwards, around 30, 40 years onwards, they have been focusing on the materials. And government also increasing the kind of means the researchers to make it materials. So that's why now our India, we are continuing now, last 10 years onwards, mainly focusing about the materials. It should be more. Should develop so much action. Should even not only government, private means companies also has to encourage and do the kind of investment on the applied means materials research like that. That will have open up so much of research opportunities and also it will be giving so much of opportunity to develop new instruments. Not only if a simple example is that, no, see how much Samsung, no, they are developing a technology within a few years onwards, actually, like that, right? And also for that we can make a so much of this employment. So that is one of the kind of greatness about the materials. So I'm very happy to have this kind of webinar in my parent institution, and I hope, and I also wish to all the participants, and I wish they will have a good research knowledge as well as basic scientific information also for their further their development, not only teaching and also research also. And thank you one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are really proud of you that you have studied in Sir CRD College and rose up to the highest position. Thank you very much. And tomorrow we are going to have your lecture, sir. Thank you. Now, it is time for to say a word of thanks for this inaugural session. Now I would like to call Dr. Paul Divakar garu to say a word of thanks for this inaugural session.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Manoj garu. Good morning, sir. To everybody, distinguished guests, our secretary of the college management, correspondent of our autonomous college, principal, vice principal, professors, my fellow members of the faculty, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning once again. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for the inaugural session of the international webinar. First, I would like to thank all the participants who joined in this auspicious occasion. On behalf of the Department of Physics and Chemistry of Sir CRD College, I would like to express a sincere appreciation and gratitude to all the resource persons, Professor Karunakar Kottapalli, USA, Professor Farzana Nasreen from USA, and Dr. Jay Prakash, Dr. Pamu, in particular, who took lots of pain for organizing the webinar. I thank the management of our college for allowing us to organize this webinar. I would like to thank Dr. MBSC Prasad Garu, our secretary, for his valuable inaugural address. Dr. K. Srishnamohan Garu, correspondent, and Professor D. Pamu, and Dr. Jay Prakash for their greetings. I thank Dr. K. Ramaraj Garu for his wonderful welcome note for the webinar. Next, I would like to thank Dr. K. Emmanuel, Vice Principal and convener of the webinar, for smooth and successful conducting the inaugural function. No one succeeds without the help of others. So, for this webinar, departments of physics and chemistry, both UG and PG, faculty and supporting staff all helped a lot. My special thanks to everyone. I also thank Mr. Swaroop, who is giving technical support. Thank you, one and all. With this, I hand over the program to our convener and vice principal, Dr. Emmanuel, sir, for further proceeding. And one announcement I want to say. After the two invited talks is over, immediately a feedback will be sent to you, and you have to fill up the feedback form. That is one point. And the other point is, those who have not registered yet, they are requested to register for this particular webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Manoj garu.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your vote of thanks. Now, we are entering into a very important one, that is a technical session one. In the technical session one, we are going to have a lecture from Professor Karunakar Kottapalli, King's University, USA. Now I want to invite Dr. B.S.N. Murthy Garu to introduce the resource person to the platform. Dr. B.S.N. Murthy.
Good morning, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. Sir, respected secretary of secretary and correspondent of Sir CRD Education Institutions, principal of Sir CRD Education Institutions, and our faculty members and all the participants, good morning, everyone. It's my privilege to introduce eminent personality, Dr. Karunakar Kottapalli. Presently, he is working as Assistant Professor of Physics, King University, Bristol, Tennessee, USA. Coming to his education, he received his doctoral degree in physics from New Mexico State University, Los Alamos Neutron Science Center. MSc, he did his MSc in physics from University of Hyderabad. He did his BSc in physics in Andhra Loyola College, Vijayawada. He started his career as a lecturer in Shiva College of Engineering and Technology, Hyderabad. Later, he moved to New Mexico State University, Las Vegas, as a teaching assistant. Then he moved to New Mexico State University as a graduate research assistant. Next, he worked as a research associate in the University of Maryland, College Park. He is working as a research associate in MS Laboratory, Iowa State University, MS, as a postdoctoral research associate. His research interests are investigation of structural and magnetic properties of correlated electron systems and their correlation with each other and with other phenomena that emerge because of the collective behavior of correlated electrons like superconductivity. He used X-ray and neutron diffraction and spectroscopic techniques like Mohs-Bayer spectroscopy, X-ray absorption near rate structure, Zanes, and X-ray magnetic circular dichroism, XMCD. He especially interested in using high pressure as a tuning parameter in addition to chemical doping. He also worked on the design and improvement of high pressure techniques using diamond anvil cells. He received prestigious awards like National Institute for Standard Techniques, American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, NIST ARRR Fellowships, and he received Outstanding Teaching Assistant Award from New Mexico State University, Las Cruces. His research interests are mainly focused on iron oxides, novel iron oxides like Fe4O5. He has around 30 publications, some of which published in prestigious journals like Nature. So this is the introduction of Dr. Karunakar Kottapalli garu, and I got him to hand over the proceedings.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Because of the signal problem, some of the parts we are unable to hear. But anyway, this is a problem not only with us. This is a problem with the internet. And now I welcome Professor Karunakar Kottapalli garu to give his valuable lecture, sir.
Dr. Emmanuel, I cannot share screen because it has been disabled from the host.
Yeah,
me to share screen.
Yeah. Yes, Swarup.
Okay. So wait, sir. Sir, co-host is no share just.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Can I go? Can I go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr.
Yes, sir.
Mukti, thank you so much for the kind introduction. I think that's the best part. I should quit now when the introduction is still good, you know, before it gets worse from my talk. But thank you to all the distinguished dignitaries over there. There were several, the correspondent principal, vice principal, chairman. There were several people there. I thank every one of you. And I thank Dr. Emmanuel for inviting me. And I also thank... one more thing before I proceed. I think you're getting requests for admitting, and I should not be admitting, but I get the request for admitting. So whoever is taking care of the technical, can you please take care of that? Okay. So anyway, so thank you all for having me. And like several of you mentioned, this is the age of material science. Okay, And you also mentioned, like to all of you mentioned, that it is also the age of multidisciplinary collaboration. It is actually very interesting to note that nature in itself does not distinguish between different sciences. Are you all able to hear me? Are you with me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I'll keep going on until somebody protests that they are not hearing or if I'm going for too long. So the nature itself does not distinguish between chemistry, physics, math, and everything. It's, I think, we who see it differently. If you truly want to understand nature, or if you want to understand the power of nature or use the power of nature, you do have to be multidisciplinary in a true sense. Like you have to combine chemistry and chemistry with physics. Okay. So, like the introduction goes, I did study in Vijayawada. Actually, I grew up in a very small place called Rayanpadu near Vijayawada. Most people, I don't know if people know it or not, but I saw that in the chat room, there are people from other places. I saw some couple from Vijayawada or close to Vijayawada. But I have not lived in Vijayawada for the last 20 years now. Once I got out, I never went back. If I go back, I go back to see my parents, but that's it. I hardly ever been to Vijayawada. But I'm very happy to see that a college in and around Vijayawada are doing a lot of good work or having scientific seminars. I keep being asked or getting informed of all the things that colleges like CR Reddy are doing, some nice conferences. It's very, very nice that you're doing this. I congratulate all of you, and I'm very happy to be part of this. So let me move on. I'm going to talk about Fe405. You know, all of you, if not all of you, I mean, most of you must have heard of iron oxides, like iron, everything that you see is around, you have to see iron everywhere. It is impossible to miss iron around you. So most of my work for the last 14 years has been understanding the fundamental properties of matter. So it is little different from what some of you are doing, because there's a lot of emphasis on application, which is perfectly correct. But I also think learning the basic properties of matter is equally important, because if we do not understand the elementary properties, basic physics, we won't be able to apply them. For example, when they found out the wave function, when they discovered the quantum tunneling, they would not have guessed what it would have led to. You know, the whole semiconductor physics is entirely based on the wave properties of the electron. So a lot of my research is based on understanding the basic properties and also finding new materials for new applications. Okay, so Fe405 is one of the new materials, and this was actually discovered only recently, only in 2011, 12, 13. But people knew that such a thing should exist for a long time. So I will, a lot of this work involves a lot of new techniques. My hope is that I introduce some new technique that most people in the world do not use. The techniques I use are actually very rare in the sense that they are advanced. So they are not available in every lab. They are available only in 3 or 4 places around the world. Okay. So my hope is that through this talk, I introduce you to a new material and some new techniques. Okay. Maybe that will expand the vast knowledge you already have. So there are a lot of phenomena people talk: superconductivity, magnetism, intermediate mixed valency, cryogenics, low temperature behavior, super hard materials, multiferroic, gravity, gravitational black holes. There's a lot. And if you look into the atom, if you look into a material, it feels like a zoo of exotic phenomena. You know, it's like there's lots of these animals playing around. And And our joy is in watching these animals and understanding these animals. I don't know if you know this, like if you kill like 1/4 of the bee population around the world, the ecosystem won't survive anymore. That means that's how much important role bees, honeybees play in keeping the ecosystem alive. Okay, so just by looking at animals, animal behavior, you learn a lot about everything else. So all these properties, supercognitive magnetism, they are like, to me, it appears like we are looking at a zoo of animals in nature, and we are just beginning to understand all the beauty. So what is at the heart of the matter? I mean, yeah, there's lots of phenomena, but what is at the heart? What is the underlying basic thing? At the heart of all phenomena, no matter what you study, either you study application-oriented like electronics, making of new electronic gadgets, making of storage devices, making of everyday electrical appliances, everything is electron. It's the behavior of electron. Once you know the state of electron in a metal or a compound, you know the ground state properties, of that metal or compound. And once we know that, and once we determine the electronic state of the material, we can manipulate it to our requirement. Okay, so electrons are not these circular objects. They have well-defined properties. What I'm showing you is, give me just a second, let me take out my laser pointer. Okay, so all these things you're seeing are these orbitals of the electrons, the wave functions, their orbital nature. So these orbital nature, these asymmetric in space, what I mean is they have some symmetry, but they're not uniform in space. Okay, they are not spherically symmetric. So these properties actually cause all the funny things that materials do. And today I'm going to talk about mostly iron. And in the periodic table, you can see iron, and iron is everywhere. I mean, there's not a thing that you cannot imagine without iron. All our buildings are steel, and steel is iron plus carbon and nickel and some other impurities to make it stronger. So there's these metals around here. There's some lanthanides and there's actinides. For the last 10 years, I have been working on lanthanides, uranium materials, and iron-based materials. They actually present two extremes. They actually present two extremes. Of the matter, and I have been working on superconductors of iron and new materials of iron. Both of them are newly prepared in the last few years. So what is it that's interesting about the iron oxides? You know rust, and that is an iron oxide. Any metallic object you leave, it eventually rusts around. Your cars, your doors, your gate, everything is metallic. If it is made of iron, it eventually you will see rust forming on it. And those are all iron oxides, and they are everywhere in nature. And you also have heard of phase diagrams, and I'll show you an example. The iron plus oxygen, you take iron and you say it's oxygen, they mix in several ratios. For example, you take hydrogen and oxygen. The two most common forms are water and hydrogen peroxide, okay, H2O and H2O2. So similarly, iron and oxygen mix in several ratios, FeO, FeO2O3, FeO3O4, and they form a very rich phase diagram. I'll show you an example of what I think of what I'm talking about, phase diagram. And investigating the phase diagram of a mixture of a material even a simple compound, even graphite, will show you several things. Like, for example, carbon makes different phases at different temperatures and pressures. So we call that phase diagram. Water, it behaves differently at different temperatures. We know that it's a different phase diagram. You have phase diagram. So two of the most common studied ones are Fe2O3 and Fe3O4, which we call as hematite and magnetite. Okay, and magnetite is one of the most intriguing substances in nature, and it has been studied for over 75 years, I think almost 100 years, and people have still not understood everything. But today, I'm going to talk about Fe4O5. It's a recent binary oxide. It was recently discovered, and it has potential for applications, and it is being studied more and more every day since its discovery. Okay, so this is an example of FeO. There is iron on this side and oxygen on this side. And as you increase the percentage of oxygen, you get different phases. So at 400 degrees centigrade, you have only iron in the BCC form and magnetite, which is Fe3O4. So at 400 degrees, you get pure iron, and you get iron in, and oxygen in the ratio 3:4. And at 800 degrees, you have iron, plus you have wustite. Wustite is nothing but FeO, but it is not perfectly 1:1 ratio of iron. There's always some mismatch. Now, if you go to 1000 to 1400 degrees, you get iron in the FCC ratio, not BCC anymore, FCC, and you have wustite too, like FeO. So you can do more, you can increase the temperature and you'll see more phases. But if you increase the iron oxygen content, you'll see some more phases. So this we call phase diagram, and you can see this for hydrogen, oxygen, there's so many of these in nature. So when you're actually studying something, like the most common way of studying materials is add one material to the other. In the olden days, in the times of Newton, in the times of Pascal, all the classic chemists and thesis, this was known as alchemy. 2000 years ago, there existed only alchemy. All alchemy meant was add together different materials, heat them up, mix them up, and see what you get. That's how you get all this bronze and all the varieties of copper. There's nothing like pure iron or pure copper. So all we have done in the history of humanity is play with the phase diagram. Now you may not realize it, or one may not know it, that they are playing with the phase diagram. But that's exactly what we are doing. We are playing with the phase diagram of these materials and getting to the right phase we want. Am I still audible to everyone? Dr. Emmanuel, am I still audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, so if you let me know if I'm off the grid. So anyway, now there's another way of looking at these phase diagrams. One is looking at the content. The other pure way, other physics and chemistry way, the pure scientific way, is looking at the pressure and temperature. You see the pressure on x-axis and temperature on y-axis on this phase diagram. So now, if you apply different pressure, now this is actually what you see in nature. This is the true form that you see in nature. The mixing of chemicals happens only in our artificial labs. In pure nature, pressure is always involved, whether or not you realize. Because every mineral, every compound, every mixture forms under the earth. And under the earth, it is not ambient pressure. It's not zero pressure. It's always some higher pressure. And as you can see, now along this line is pressure at 10 GPa, at 20 GPa, 30 GPa, 40 GPa, 50 GPa. GPa is the earth's pressure. Now, if you want to think about earth's pressure, the pressure at the earth's core, like if you go all the way to the center of the earth, is like 300 to 400 GPa. Okay. at the surface, at the mantle and crust, it's like 4, 5, 6 GPa. So the deeper you go, the higher the pressure. Diamond forms at 2 GPa. Coal forms anywhere between 0.5 GPa to 3 GPa, depending on how hard, how low you are going. So now, if you go to up to 800 degrees, you see some kind of compounds. You only see a mixture of magnetite, hematite, and wustite, that is Fe2O3, Fe3O4, and FeO. But if you go to higher temperatures, you see some very fancy things. I'm not going to describe everything, but what I'm going to point out is a lot of this is not understood well. People keep studying this. Now, why do we need to understand it? The reason we are trying to understand it, because it is in the nature. That's the simplest reason. Everything we apply in our life is, we apply because it is in the nature. So all these are in the nature and we are using them in everyday life. That's why we try to understand them. Now, what has happened in the recent years is we have developed more tools, more techniques, more powerful ways of understanding them. So in that process, we have discovered more phases of the same materials that were known to us for thousands of years. So now if you see this blue diamond, this one is a completely new phase that was discovered only like 7 years ago. And this was discovered by Barbara Levina. I worked with Barbara Levina for some time. I still work with her on and off. She's an Italian scientist. And she discovered this compound and I started working with her at that time. So if you go to 10 GPa, which is a very high pressure, I'll talk about what pressure means, what 1 GPa means and what half GPa means in the next slide. But if you look at this blue diamond, this is where FeO4 forms. That means at 10 GPa at over 1700 Kelvin, which is like 1100 centigrade. Okay. So at this temperature, Fe4O5 forms. Now, what is the big deal? Okay, I mixed iron and oxide in another ratio. So what's the big deal? I mean, why is it important? It is important because it was showing up in every experiment for the last 50 years. Everyone knew that there is something odd here, but nobody knew what it is until Barbara finally figured it's actually a new phase of FeO. So that's the big deal about it. It's like trying to find the electron. You know, when Davison and Germer performed their experiments, and when people, and then Thomson said, okay, this is electron. People knew that there was electron for a long, long time. People knew that there is something here. You know, there is a particle, it is charged, but it seems like it exists, but we don't know what it is and what it does and what are its properties. So people knew for a long time, and there was a debate between a group in England and in Europe trying to understand what this is. And then suddenly J.J. Thomson boldly declared, guys, this is a new particle. This is electron. This is a particle with charge. And then a whole new world arrived. Okay. This is the age of electron, if you want to say it. From 1900 and on, it's the age of the electron. Without electron, you can't do anything. Everything you see is because of electron. So that's the big deal with this compound. For 50 years, this Fe4O5 was showing up in all sorts of experiments, but nobody knew what it is. I mean, it shows up everywhere. So when Barbara boldly declared, guys, this is actually a new compound. This is its crystal structure. So we need to pay attention because it is everywhere. So even in the low temperature phase, all of this H, when you see this H, and H, there's always this Fe4O5 involved somewhere. Okay, so that's the big deal about Fe4O5. Now, there are a lot of applications around it. I'm not going to discuss applications because now the talk will become much larger. I only want to introduce something new to you. You know, if I'm coming all the way from USA and Dr. Emmanuel and all the people have made an effort to bring someone new, it would be very injustice if I don't introduce something new to you. Okay, so let me introduce this to you. Now, what is pressure really? I mean, what do you mean by 10 GPa of pressure? So pressure, if you know, is just force over area. So do you know why a ball pen won't make a hole, but a simple pin, you know, like safety pin makes a hole in your finger? Because your safety pin exerts far more pressure. It is force, pressure is force over area. You apply the same force but decrease the area. That means you take a pencil and pin it on your finger. Like you take this pencil and push it on your hand, it won't make a hole. But you take a safety pin, it will go through, because safety pin has very less area. You know, like this nail, like the heel. Okay. So that's why you never annoy any young lady wearing a heel, because she will stamp on your feet and press and then it will be very hurtful. So an elephant, for example, an elephant feet is 15 centimeters and an average elephant weighs 3 kilograms. So that the pressure generated by an elephant is 4 atm. So 1 GPa, I was talking about GPa here on this scale. I'm talking about GPa. So 1 GPa is 10,000 atmospheres. That means it is 10,000 times the atmospheric pressure. We always have atmospheric pressure on our heads, on our body. If there's no atmospheric pressure, we will instantly die. So having pressure is not a bad thing. So if you're struggling with pressure at work, don't always think it is bad. It is actually good. Thank your superiors for the pressure they exert on you. So 1 GPa is about 10,000 atmosphere. And the pressure in Mariana Trench, it's the deepest point on the earth. It's in the Pacific Ocean. It's about 1,000 atmosphere and it's only 0.1 GPa. Okay, so why is high pressure important? High pressure and high temperature important? Because there are lots of applications that we use in every day. We use diamond for cutting. We use diamond for lots of application. If you go to a dentist, I think maybe some of you have gone to the dentist for whatever reason, for toothache or for having a new tooth, for something. Lot of dentist tools are made of diamonds because they are very sharp. They're very strong. Okay. And diamonds are used for cutting, drying, drilling, polishing. They're used in lasers. They're used in X-ray machines. Okay, and diamond is a product of high pressure and high temperature. We need 5 GPa and 11,000 degrees centigrade. You may be surprised to know that it's actually, even after so much of increase in science and technology, we cannot make diamonds like nature makes. We still rely on nature largely, diamonds. The African mines are the biggest source. Okay, and another way of seeing diamonds, another way of seeing the usefulness of high pressure and high temperature, if you have gone to any machine shop, you may have seen cutting tools. A lot of those cutting tools are made of what is called boron nitride. Now, boron nitride is made from hexagonal boron nitride. They are the same boron nitride, but this is hexagonal, this is cubic. Cubic form and hexagonal form. That means in hexagonal form, the atoms are arranged in hexagonal shapes. In the cubic, they're arranged as cubes, just atoms in cube. So now if you heat the hexagonal boron nitride at 2100 degrees centigrade, 7 GPa, you get boron nitride. That's how you get all these cutting tools. So having high pressure and high temperature is very, very essential in everyday life. You can't do anything without it. If you have built a house, just know that you could not have built a house without high pressure and high temperature. So how is it related to my work? So the way they discovered high pressure phase, Fe405, is using something called diamond anvil cell. So I can share details more, but later, if we get a chance to meet, or if you want to email or anything, but I'll just gloss over it because I don't have much time. I only have 15 minutes more. So diamond anvil cell is nothing but two diamonds. Here is a diamond. Here is a diamond. You put a material in between and press them. that is basically applying the diamond, using a diamond anvil cell. So when these two objects close, this one closes on this one. So you have a diamond anvil cell and you can apply pressure on objects. That is how you are getting all these application tools. Actually, there's not much you can do in life without applying this high pressure. So I'm not going to all of this. I am just showing all the things related to diamond pressure, diamond anvil cells. There's several kinds of pressure cells. And just to let you know, emphasize again that all of these are useful in everyday life. So how did we synthesize Fe405? You cannot synthesize this. You cannot make this in your lab like chemists do by mixing iron and oxygen. So you take a diamond anvil cell, put iron and oxygen, or put iron here, pure iron, 99.99% pure iron. And all this has to be done in glove box. And you shine laser on both sides. Okay. So, and you heat it. Okay. Then once you heat, if you shine X-rays through the diamond anvil cell, you will see nice pattern of Fe405. So that's how you make Fe405. So you need iron plus 1:5 ratio of iron and magnetite, and you heat at 1300K at 13 GPa. That means you see these screws here, tighten them so that you get 1313 GPa. And then you use laser beams, infrared laser beams, to generate a heat of 1300K inside the diamond anvil cell. And then you get Fe405. Okay, and this is how it looks inside it. We are looking through the diamond through a microscope. This picture is through the diamond through a microscope. Okay, so that's how you get Fe405. And this is the X-ray pattern. Oh, I just want to tell you one more detail. You send the laser beam and the X-ray at the same time. These are actually extremely complicated optics and setup. There's only three places in the world who do this, or maybe four. Okay. That have this capability. So we have access to one of those, and then we do this there. So the X-ray beam is only 4 by 5 micron. One micron is only 1/1000th of a millimeter. That means 1000 millimeter, 1000 microns make 1 millimeter. Our X-ray beam is only 4 micrometer by 5 micrometer. And we get a sample of only 15 micrometers. These are all very, very small, but that's what you need to do proper research. And the X-ray beam is 30 keV. So for all the chemists and physicists and all the material scientists who are on this webinar, the typical X-ray energy use is not 30 keV. It's anywhere between 9 to 17 keV, depending on what target you are using. Molybdenum can get you like 17 keV, but that's it. You don't get much more than that. We do this all at synchrotron, so we can go up to 30 keV. So this is the pattern of Fe405. And as you can see, now when you start heating and take X-ray, you only get this pattern. But once you go to 1308 GPa, you see the stars. These are all Fe405. Now again, once take away the pressure, you still have the Fe405. Now this is another very unique thing about Fe405. A lot of material form at high pressure and high temperature, but not everything can be recovered at ambient pressure. What do you mean by that? That means you make something at high pressure and high temperature, but once you come back to ambient pressure, that means room pressure and room temperature, that compound you cannot get back. It is lost. But Fe405 is very unique. You can have it even after you take away the high pressure. So this is the Fe405 crystal structure, and it has three kinds of sites. That means it has iron atoms, but all iron atoms do not have the same local structure. So you have Fe1 with six atoms surrounding it, Fe2, 6 atoms surrounding it, Fe3 also 6 atoms surrounding it, but not the arrangement is not all same. This gives you different properties. If you have been following chemistry, you know that these the arrangement of atoms around a given atom will give different properties. Okay, so what I'm going to show you is now is only one aspect. There's a lot to it, but I only want to show you one other new thing. I've shown you two new things already. One is the unusual use of pressure temperature phase diagram. The other one is use synthesizing materials at high pressure and high temperature doing Eyman Daniel cells. The third one I'm going to show is Mossbauer spectroscopy. Again, a lot of you know Mossbauer spectroscopy, but I'm going to show you a different form of Mossbauer spectroscopy. Because of time constraint, I'm not going into extreme detail of all of this. My hope is that I encourage you to get to know something new, and maybe if you are interested, you can find out more details and maybe even use in your research. Okay, so typical Mossbauer spectroscopy, you have something like a radioactive source, like a cobalt. You put in an absorber. What is your absorber? It's just your sample, like whatever sample you have. And you have a detector. So you shine the gamma rays, because cobalt is radioactive source. You shine the photons coming out of this. Now cobalt gives photons of 14 keV, approximately 14.14 keV. And if the iron atom has magnetism, that means it has some magnetic moment. What do you mean by having magnetic moment? That means it has some spin on it. All electrons have spin, and sometimes in some compounds they are magnetic. Not everyone is magnetic. The detail I'm not going to do why. But if you have a magnetic moment and there is a magnetic structure, there are different kinds of magnetic structures: ferromagnetic and ferromagnetic, ferry, so on. So if there is a magnetic structure in this sample, now it absorbs some of the photons and the detector collects the ones that are not absorbed. So when the sample with magnetic atom sees the photon, it gets excited and the levels, energy levels split. The split energy levels, because of the magnetic moment, they get populated. Now again, iron comes back to the ground state. Again, this is all elementary theory, so I'm not going to go into much detail. And you see a pattern like this. What are these? Whenever an energy is absorbed, you see a dip. That means that photon no longer exists. So if you have a magnetic structure, you see a nice pattern. So this is a compound without any magnetism. Now this is pure iron, because iron is magnetic. As you know, if you have iron and a magnet, the magnet attracts all of them. You will see this kind of pattern. If there is no magnetism, you see a simple dip. Okay. So why do we use Mossbauer? The Mossbauer gives site-specific information. And why do we want to do this? Because whenever we get a new compound, we first identify all of its properties. Okay. So it gives site-specific information, the electronic environment. Okay. I'm going to skip the isomer shift, because it's a completely different part. Oxidation state, we are not concerned with it right now. And if you couple Mossbauer and X-ray diffraction, you can learn something about it. So now all I talked about is lab Mossbauer, using in lab. Okay. So I only have 10 more minutes, so I'll try to go fast. One drawback of using Mossbauer spectrum in lab, in our regular home lab, is it takes a long, long time. It takes about three days sometime to collect the data. But one way to improvise is go to a synchrotron source. A synchrotron, this is actually a circle of diameter more than kilometer. So this whole thing is like 2 kilometers. Okay, this circle, if you start walking, it will be 2 kilometers. So when electrons go in the circle, it's close to speed of light, they emit photons. Okay, and that photons we use to shine on the sample. So this is all the source, the synchrotron source we did these experiments. And this is a typical synchrotron where you have stations. Okay, each one you can do one experiment. X-ray going round and round will emit photons. Okay, and you collect these photons and do experiment. So in the synchrotron, it's the same principle. The photons come, hit the sample, and you get a pattern. But the corresponding pattern for this looks like this one. Okay, it's a little complicated, but it's the same thing. For those who are thinking in simple terms, like me, it is basically a Bessel function and a linear attenuation. That means a linearly, an exponentially decreasing function and a Bessel function. A Bessel function is nothing but a sine function with a changing period and amplitude. Okay, so it's just the same. You can model it very easily. So we collected nuclear forward scattering. It's called also nuclear forward scattering. Okay, the Mossbauer spectroscopy done at synchrotron is called nuclear forward spectroscopy. Okay, because it's a nuclear thing and it's forward scattering. That means you always see in the forward direction, in the direction of the incident one. So we collected spectrum at different pressures. Okay, so why are we doing this? Because we know that Fe405 is magnetic. We also want to understand how the magnetism evolves with pressure. Now, why is it important? Because all memory devices use pressure. I don't know if you realize this or not. All memory devices usually start their application research with a thin film. And thin films need pressure to make. It is strain. So once we understand how magnetism behaves under pressure, we can understand how to manipulate the spin. That way we can understand the scope of application. So we applied from 0 to 41 GPa, and you see all these patterns, they're all slightly different, but they are different. They are actually not exactly same. Like I said, in simple terms, it is basically a Bessel term and a exponential term, linearly exponential thing. So what you are seeing is a time. That means photons get absorbed and the atoms get excited and they de-excite, and the released photons, which come after a few nanoseconds, they are collected in the detector. That's how you get this pattern. So after 30 nanoseconds, you get so many photons. After 60 nanoseconds, you get so many photons. After 100 nanoseconds, you get any photons. So you collect how many photons are coming at different nanoseconds. Okay, this is all a very short interval of time. Nanosecond is very, very short interval of time. But a lot happens in a second. The world is going at a different speed. You know, we are living in two different time domains. There's lots happening in nano and micro scale. We are living in a different scale. Okay, so that's how life is. But it's important to understand that there's a world outside our world and there's a world within our world. Okay, and we need to merge all of them to have a good life. So you can see this pattern, and these patterns are because there's a spin here on the central atom. In the surrounding atoms, oxygen atoms, have an electric field influence on the central atom for all these three atoms. That's how you get the pattern. That is the origin for the pattern and not some simple dumb straight line. Okay. So now we fit. So black is fit, red is data. We fit to the same thing, like I said, a simple exponential from a Bessel function, but I'm making it very simple, but we fit to some function that extract these parameters. And what parameters do we extract? We extract two parameters, something called hyperfine magnetic field, and it gives you an idea of the magnetic moment. Okay, again, these are all basic physics. These are all basically intermediate physics, but applied at a higher level. So please do not think of it as something abstract. These are all concepts from your intermediate, but applied at a deeper level. Okay, so you have a hyperfine magnetic field. That means the magnetic field exerted on the spin on the iron nucleus by the surrounding electron, and the electric field by the oxygen atoms. Okay, so those are the two things that cause this pattern. So this represents the magnetic field on the central iron atom by its nucleus of the iron atom by the electrons. And this electric field, effect of electric field on the iron nucleus by the surrounding oxygen atoms. So we get information of the iron atom spin and the surrounding oxygen atoms. So what this tells us is that there is spin, there is magnetic moment. Oops, excuse me. So I have to escape. Okay. So the spin is more or less constant actually. That means you have a very, very stable iron oxide, and you have an iron oxide that is very complex. This is actually a very complex pattern for these compounds, for iron oxides. If you go and see other iron oxide quadrupole splitting, that means the effect of the electric field on the central iron atom due to other oxygen atom, this is very complex one. We have not understood yet, because the effect is actually increasing. We do not know yet how, but we have a theory that the atoms, because of the pressure, atoms are getting closer, the electric field is increasing, but it's not so simple. We also did theoretical calculations for each of them, and you see that our theoretical calculations, I'm going a little faster here, please forgive me. The magnetic moment, our theoretical calculations support our experiment, because in all three of them, you see the magnetic moment 3.6, 3.8, 3.6. But what is also interesting to note is the minus plus minus, you see the three signs. This indicates a magnetic antiferromagnetic structure. So what have we achieved by doing this? See, the difficulty, a simple thing that most people want to do after getting a new compound is, what is its crystal structure? What is its magnetic structure? See, for compounds like HE4, Fe4O5, it is very difficult to determine its magnetic structure directly, because you cannot use this in the neutron, with a neutron diffraction. So you have to find it using small samples. So we found the magnetic structure using Mossbauer spectroscopy and theoretical calculations, and we established that it is an antiferromagnetic structure. I'm concluding this without much detail because we are out of time now. So what did we achieve? What did I introduce? I introduced to you the pressure temperature phase diagram of materials. I introduced to you that the idea that you can generate, you can make new materials using pressure, high pressure and high temperature. And I introduced you a new compound called Fe4O5. And I said that it is very new, it is very exciting, because it is a compound that can be synthesized at high pressure, but recovered at ambient pressure. And we have shown that it is antiferromagnetic in nature. Now, if you go and search literature, there are so many nature papers. Every paper on Fe4O5 is a nature paper, because it has become so important. My paper gets cited after every few months, because it is very difficult, but people want to do it. So it's a very exciting new work. I want to thank, I owe some acknowledgement to Barbara and Urchin. These two people supported me. And of course, Farzana, we worked together. I don't want to go through the other slides. I thought if there is time, I will go into the details of what he talked about, but I'll stop there. Okay, to summarize, I'm introducing a new compound that is made at high pressure, and we determine its magnetic structure using a Mossbauer spectroscopy used in a different way. So there's lots of new things I introduced. If you're interested, please go and study them. If you ever feel like, you can email me. I'll be happy to answer in any way. So I'll stop there. Dr. Emmanuel, I think I stopped in a good time. I did not take more time. I know that all of you have time is valuable. Dr. Emmanuel. Is anybody able to hear?
Yes, sir, we can able to hear your voice.
Oh, okay, okay. So I'm done with my talk. If there is any questions, I'll be happy to answer. I hope you got at least something, you heard at least something new, even if not in entire detail. Yeah.
No problem. Your work is very good. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It means a lot to me. Yeah. That you think.
Anybody ask questions?
Yeah.
Otherwise, I will ask you, I have one or two questions I will ask afterwards.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Karunakar?
Yes.
This is Srinivas Prasad from KL University.
Okay.
Your lecture was very good. But
thank you very much. Yeah.
I'm overwhelmed that, if you remember, we were classmates at Kendriya Vidyalaya Vijayawada campus.
Yeah, I remember some of them. I met Surendra a long time ago.
Yeah, yeah. Myself, Srinivas Prasad, we were classmates at KV Vijayawada, 12th, 11th and 12th class.
Srinivas Prasad, who lived in Madhura Nagar?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, so nice to meet you. I don't know, I would meet you here. Where are you?
No, I am at Vijayawada KL University, okay. Working in physics department.
That is very nice, Srinivas.
No, I should, though this is a private chat, I should not talk here, but I have tried many attempts to get your contact, myself and Surendra, but we couldn't get your contact.
If you have done on WhatsApp, I actually use very little of WhatsApp, Srinivas. I think others are getting bored. I will again connect. And now I know that you are trying to contact me on WhatsApp. I think you're trying to contact me on WhatsApp. Okay, I'll get back to you. Let's do the webinar thing and then we'll
reconnect.
Okay. I'll reconnect. Yeah, any other questions? Srinivas will definitely connect. I just don't use WhatsApp that much. That's why I miss people. Yeah.
Sir, can I ask one question?
Yes, please, please.
So that you have presented, no?
May I know who is asking? I actually can't see or...
Probably, you know, my name is Jay Prakash.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Sorry, no. Mr. Jay Prakash. Yeah.
Yes, MSc and a PhD in Hyderabad University.
Oh, okay. Very nice. Which during which time?
That is, you know, 2000 to 2008.
Oh, okay. Okay. So you're...
You forgot my name, chemistry department.
You know, when I was in the University of Hyderabad, I was the most boring and dumbest fellow. I'm still. But now because I have to interact, some of the dumbness has gone down because of friends like you. But I'm still the same boring. So I probably, forgive me if I did not connect well.
But you, I know that you given one or two times, you know, you given a message also in the prayer. Anyway, so that FE3, you know?
4A5, 405, yeah.
405, that new material is very good actually. Of course, that since it's also very critical and difficult also. That's time and environment, something like that. We told that since this is a very, you know, it's a harsh conditions we had used.
Yes.
Fine. And also, once it was, you know, synthesized, and when you take it to the material to ambient conditions, it is stable.
Yes. Yes.
So I didn't see in the literature, but any people has developed any applications from the material?
Oh, the reason this is being studied? No, the applications, you know, we are in basic physics. So our job is to, I mean, we, Farzan and I are involved in a lot of design too. We work with only three or four designers of these high pressure cells. And it's a very rapidly growing, very popular field actually nowadays, because now the techniques have come. The field started way back in 1950s, but because of lack of enough technology, it's only developing now, and there are not many people who do what we're doing. But coming to the question, the application when it comes will be how to manipulate spin under pressure. You know, because as I said, thin films, there is always strain on the thin film. And that's where all memory devices applications start from, understanding a thin film. That's why spintronics is such a huge field and such an important field. So what we are providing basically is another material for the spintronics guys and another material to test for the thin films. Okay, I did not talk about my other study that I'm doing here, FESC, where FESC and FE405 together, they provide a much larger playing field. Okay, my FE405 paper and FESER paper I do not mean to brag, but I'm just saying they are hugely cited because of this very nature, because we showed something very fundamental in nature for people to play with. So there is no immediate application that I'm very sorry about.
No problem. Not only maybe other vibration because research groups in the rest of the world, no? Just any people know, means they, you know, take the material and start, you know, developing any application. That's what I want to know.
Yeah, no, it has led to other developments, which I'll maybe talk to you differently, because It may be a little detailed for all the audience involved. If you ever have a chance, maybe I'll describe to you what it led to, what happened because of that.
Yeah. Okay, fine.
Any other question? Is Dr. Emmanuel still there with us, or is he busy? Because I want to hand over. If there is no more question, I think I can hand over.
Okay, maybe you can continue the next talk.
Oh, okay. Maybe.
Any questions from the audience? You can interact with Professor Karunakar Kottapalli. If there is nothing to interact with Karunakar, Professor Karunakar, then we will move on to the next talk.
Farzana, okay. is will be in a minute. I'll start in maybe introduce Farzana. She also happens to be my wife. but we have been working together for a long time. I'm just filling the space here. I don't mean to occupy your time with unnecessary detail. But she will be talking about another fundamental aspect, which has led to huge fields. What I have talked about is 3D electrons. What Farzana will share is about 5F electrons. The whole world, if you take the whole world, the application is based on how we are tuning 3D, 4F and 5F electrons. All the transition metals are 3D, all the lanthanides, you take any lanthanide, ytterbium, actinium, you take lanthanides and actinides, they are everywhere, in your car, in your batteries. We owe a lot to rare earth metals. Okay. So the rare earth metals are 4F electrons and the actinides are 5F electrons. So the whole world is centered around these 3D, 4F and 5F electrons. So I spoke about 3D electrons. Farzana will talk about manipulating the properties of 5F electrons in a different way to understand how to apply it. Actually, there's lots and lots of reason why people study 5F, and they're extremely crucial. Even current, considering the current the socio-political scenario. This is not the right platform to talk about socio-political scenario, but India and the world depends on one country for certain metals. We do not have the privilege to speak about that, but a part of Farzana research goes into finding alternatives, but to find the alternatives, we need to understand the basic properties of the 5F electrons. So that's what Farzana's work is related. We both work on different aspects and the same places. And we are both working high pressure labs. There are only 3 or 4 in the world and we both work there. I think it's just God's grace that we get to work there. Farzana is here. I will hand over it to her. She did PhD with me. We both did in the same group. And then, but we did post research work after PhD at different places. Farzana works in US, in addition to a research work and her faculty work, she also works with Bloom India. Bloom India is an SO in the, is an organization that is helping underprivileged students in India, underprivileged children in India. And this year we were in Bangalore only for that work. We were helping set up the academy for the underprivileged children. So Farzana is involved with both the Bloom India and my university. So I'm giving it over. Thank you very much for letting me fill the time. Not that I want to speak about my wife.
Thank you, sir. Both the couple, Professor Karunakar and Professor Farzana. Now we are going to have a talk from Farzana. Before that, Pawan Kumar, our head of the Department of PG Physics, will introduce Professor Farzana. Then the time will be given to Professor Farzana. Madam, after the introduction of Pawan Kumar, you have to continue the talk. Thank you. Over to Pawan. Pawan, speak on.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon. It is audible, sir?
Yeah, audible.
Sir? Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Respected secretary, correspondent, principal, and participants in the webinar, I welcome you all. It's a privilege to introduce today resource person, Professor Farzana Narseen, King University, Bristol, USA. She has done her BSc in physics and B.Ed. in physical science and mathematics from Pondicherry University, MSc in physics from University of Hyderabad, and PhD in physics from New Mexico State University. She held various positions in education sector as education advisor, education consultant, research assistant, and teaching assistant. She has honored with merit scholarship and with gold medal for women topper in physics from University of Hyderabad. She got 8 years of research experience and 14 years of teaching experience. She attended 8 conferences and presented papers, and she published 11 papers in peer-reviewed journals. With this short, brief introduction, I would like to thank the management for giving this opportunity to introduce today's resource person. Thank you, one and all. Professor?
Yes. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, you can continue, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Pawan Kumar, for the introduction.
Thank you, ma'am.
Along with that, I also want to thank you, everyone, for... the organizer for this international webinar, Principal, Vice Principal Dr. Emmanuel, and other faculties and dignitaries. I'm very humbled to be invited to this, because currently I'm working more with Bloom India, and my plan is to go back to the research field, but my husband and I, we took break for some time, and we wanted to invest in the life of young students in India, especially those who have a high aptitude in science but are underprivileged. Who are underprivileged but have very high aptitude in science. These are really bright students, but do not have access to quality education. So we felt that we need to spend in those particular population as well, along with our teaching and research responsibilities at the university. So I'll briefly mention about the Bloom India program. We are currently working with underprivileged girls, and we are starting a learning center and academy in Bengaluru for them. But due to COVID, we are not able to start, but we are doing all online as much as we can, and providing them this platform and a place and resources and everything. And these are really bright young girls from Karnataka that have joined our academy, and they'll be starting their science stream program in PUC, pre-university college program. So, and as well as I'm still working with the research and teaching in USA. So I will go ahead and share my screen with all of you. Okay, so I will be giving my talk. Let me just keep tap off time. I'm starting at 12:13. I'll try my best to finish by 1 p.m. So I will be talking on 2 uranium compound. They are called heavy fermion compound, and I'll come to that, what it means by saying heavy fermion. They are 2 compounds which are more or less similar in nature, but they're the two are different in the sense is in the first compound, the uranium copper aluminum series family of compound, I have used physical properties measurement technique to study their nature. And in the other compound, I used a complementary technique, but it's the same same compound we are probing, same kind of nature, but we are using two different approach. One is a more direct measurement, other is an spectroscopic measurement. And in the first compound, we have used chemical pressure. But in the second one, which KK has talked a little bit about, is the hydrostatic pressure, more mechanical pressure we have applied. And the, on the background, what you see is, the I am from Andaman, Port Blair. And if you get chance, I would encourage you all to visit. And it's really known for its pristine and clean beaches. So sometime when we both get time, we go on some of the remote island for 10 to 15 days. So this, we went on the Neal Island. There are two couple of islands, Havelock and Neal Island. And this is, we were spending, so my husband and I, we were spending time on that island for 10 days last summer. So we took some shots, and this is one of the beautiful picture on the background. Okay, this is coming on the way. It's okay.
Yeah.
There's something, people are coming in the room, so that's fine. So if you see here, we have two series of elements from periodic table, which are relatively less talked. One is lanthanides and other is actinides. KK talked about iron, which has 3D, outermost electron is in the 3D orbital. So F electron here, you in the above series that you see is all 4F electron, and the below actinide series is a 5F electron. Although my work is very on the fundamental physics level, but the application of these, the compound is very, very high. For example, for the lanthanide, if you take your car, the modern car that we have, or your smartphone or your computer, you, if you rip it apart and open it, you can actually see a lot of rare earth elements in them. Actually, some people, who they collect the old computers, and they can make actually a lot of money by selling all these rare earth elements from the old computers. They're very costly, and it is routinely used in all these smart devices and new computers, all the computers that we have. The second series, that is the 5F electron actinides, we use them a lot in nuclear power, as well as another thing which is very common these days is in the cancer research therapy. We use chemotherapy, and we use proton therapy, and some of these actinide compound that are made in Knoxville in Tennessee, there is a research lab called Oak Ridge National Lab that particularly some of the elements that if you go outside, they are actually not naturally available, and they are bombarded by neutrons to make them, and they use them in cancer research. You can make it, make these isotopes, and you can make it in a way, fashion it is portable, and you can ship it to medical and hospitals for cancer research therapy. So the application is very huge. And since applied science and basic science, they go together. So our laboratory in National High Magnetic Field Laboratory, we have both the fundamental research department as well as the applied science. Another example that I want to give is, I routinely work on a lot of superconducting magnets. The one that I have worked can go up to 20 Tesla of magnetic field. It used niobium tin or titanium, niobium titanium. And the lab where I was working in Los Alamos and Tallahassee is famous for its world record for the highest magnetic field. They have a very world-class facility to make these magnets, and you know, the new unconventional superconductors, those who are in the materials science, they know these cube rates, that yttrium, barium, copper oxide ones. They have been actually successful, I don't know, maybe in 2017 they tested it. And so I used purely like conventional superconductor, the simple one, but they use it to wind it into a coil, and they short the current, and they could go up to record high of 45 Tesla, roughly up to 45 Tesla magnet. So our whole team, although we work on fundamental, we all work together, and it has huge application. Those who are maybe in chemistry and maybe in biochem, the application of these superconductor is huge. One quick medical application is the MRI machine that you see in most of the big super specialty hospital. They all use these superconducting magnets. So I'll come to my talk. Here, if you see lanthanide, the outermost electron that is outermost orbital that is involved is 4f, and the outermost orbital that is involved is 4f, and in actinides 5f is involved. Here I have electronic configuration of uranium, and you see 5f have 3 electrons, and 60 and 7s 60 have 1 and 7s has 2 electrons. Now why I'm talking about this orbital is because at the fundamental level, how the the properties of these compound, the uranium or the 4F compound, these are governed by these outermost orbital. So if you see this on this left side, I have wave function for 4F, 5F and 3D. So if you see the 5F, this has very interesting wave function. It's the radial density versus radius on the y x-axis. If you see the 5F wave function, the spatial extension of this 5F wave function compared to 4F and 3D is more. 4F is more like atomic, it is more localized, it is more atomic-like, whereas 5F wave function, 5F orbital is more, have more a spatial extension. And because of that nature, it is very sensitive to pressure, both chemical and hydrostatic pressure, as well as magnetic field, as well as doping. When I say chemical pressure, it is doping. And by using those parameters, you can really play with the ground state properties. So I'll show some of the consequence of this 5F nature because of this large spatial extension. I will quickly summarize some of the very interesting exotic ground states that we see in this uranium compound that is not seen in other simple metals. One is the huge magnetocrystalline anisotropy. And so if you see the graph of magnetization of this uranium cobalt gallium compound, you can see there is a huge change in the magnetization. If you apply magnetic field along the basal plane, these all compounds have hexagonal structure. If you apply field along the C-axis, and if you apply perpendicular to the C-axis, then you will see there is a huge change in the magnetization. And the people who work with electromagnets for power generation and even in your making like permanent magnets, they exploit this property a lot. Second is the complex magnetic ordering. If you see this, this is really not very simple. We routinely see very complex magnetic ordering in these compounds. For example, this cyclic arrangement of spins here. Then third is the heavy fermion that I will go a little more in detail. When I say heavy fermion, what I mean is that heavy by name itself, it is heavy. We are talking about the mass of the electron. So I'll go later in more depth. So if you see, when we measure the simple specific heat, the calorimetry experiment that we all have done in our PUC level, it's a very interesting experiment. And if you measure the electronic contribution to the specific heat at very low temperature, when I say low temperature, somewhere below 10, even below 5 Kelvin, you will see the contribution from the electrons to the electronic to the specific heat. It becomes very high in the compound, in these compounds. For example, if you take simple sodium metal, it is 1. But if you see all these cerium, praseodymium, ytterbium, and uranium, 4F and 5F compound, the gamma is really very, very high. Then, as I talked about unconventional superconductivity, here is a uranium-germanium-2 unconventional superconductor. And you can see as you suppress on the y-axis, we have temperature and we have pressure. And you can increase the pressure to suppress the critical temperature. And this is the critical temperature, not the critical temperature, Curie temperature, long-range ferromagnetic arrangement, and bring it to very, very low temperature. And almost you practically remove all thermal vibration, and you have quantum vibration that helps the coupling of magnetism, the new superconducting that we're seeing. It is quantum fluctuation in this My pointer, is it visible or I have to use the pointer? Okay, so if you see this region, this is where we have quantum fluctuation, where we see unconventional kind of superconductivity behavior. So what we have is, so in terms of magnetism, what our challenge is with the 5F uranium compound is that we don't have a complete theory. So the theory that we have is, one is the Lopez, another is the itinerant theory for magnetism. When I say localized theory, what I have is, for example, for the 4F electron, they are more atomic-like orbital. They are more stick to the nucleus, and the electron is not free to roam the, they're not leaving the parent nucleus. So you have to consider the coupling of the orbital and the spin angular momentum based on this local moment theory. Whereas if you come to the itinerant, all the 3D, 4D, 5D transition elements, your electron, they leave totally this the parent nucleus. And so the coupling is very simple. It's only spin part there. There's no orbital moment. So these are very well established one. But when you come to the 5F electron, because it keeps varying from compound to compound, from parameter to parameter, we do not have a robust theory like these two to have a well-defined theory for this compound. So that is one of the motivation for us to study. So what I used is, in the first talk, I will talk about measuring the physical property of this compound. I literally connect wires to this compound. So these are the physical property that I measured: resistivity, magnetization, magnetic susceptibility, specific heat, Seebeck effect, thermopower. And you know that we study, we measure all these physical properties to see different behaviors. For example, if you have conductors, insulators, semiconductors, they all will give different graphs, different features will be seen. Similarly, superconductors and magnets, they will be showing different features. And then we have different theories to explain. So we have studied very simple classical Drude model we have. Then we have the simple Sommerfeld model that applied the quantum theory, like particle in a box. And then we have a little more advanced, like applying Fermi quantum theory with Fermi Dirac statistics, applying the whole statistical approach to the electron gas. And then we have the new one, where maybe at the MSc level not taught so much, is the Fermi liquid theory that Landau, he applied to explain the superfluid property of liquid helium-3 isotope. So we will be I will show some of the theory that how we use it in our data. So I will not have time to go through all the physical properties. So I will just talk about specific heat. So what is a specific heat? A specific heat is very simple. What you do is you take a unit mass. Basically, you define how much energy you need to raise the temperature for a unit mass of substance by unit degree of temperature. So that's how standard it is defined. This is a simple experiment. And if you see when you are studying all the theory for solids, the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution that consider all the electron, this is a classical approach. You apply this statistics to the electron gas. The simple electronic specific heat comes out to be 3/2 NKB, with KB as the Boltzmann constant. And for the Fermi gas, using the Fermi Dirac statistics, C electron comes out to be, basically what I'm pointing is, in the quantum particle in a box in Fermi gas, it is proportional to N temperature, okay? This whole factor you see can be taken as constant gamma, which I have mentioned here. At low temperature, gamma T, this is the contribution from the electron. That gamma has, if you look out all the terms, it has density of states at the Fermi surface. So it is related to the mass of the electron. That is what I'm interested in, and I'll come to that. The second term is the beta T cube, is the lattice contribution. All the big terms of Debye at low temperature, it boils down to very simple term beta T cube. So I'm more interested in electronic. The reason I'm more interested in the electronic contribution is because in all these compounds that I'm listing, the 4F and the 5F compound, the electron-electron interaction is very strong. That is the what, that's actually, there is a whole branch called strongly correlated electron system in which all this come. And if you take simple metal, you can think of the electron-electron interaction is almost zero. There is none, almost zero. We can neglect it, it's negligible. But when you come to these heavy metals, the electron-electron interaction is so huge. So when we measure this CV specific heat, this factor that you see m star by m, this mass of electron that what we measure, and if you divide it by the simple electronic mass, you will not get it one. Usually m star by m should be one for sodium metal. But if you do it for helium 3, you get it 3. And we know that superfluidity, which is because of that heavy mass. But in our compound, some of them, if you measure and find this, some of them are like 2000, so very high. So in my lab, what I usually have is a calorimeter, and this is a magnet here. So this is in the magnet goes the calorimeter, and on the calorimeter you have sample on the substrate, and you have a small heater and thermometer. Simply you supply some heat the sample, and you record the decay temperature, and you measure a specific heat. So this is the graph for a simple metal. And if you see some of the 4F compounds, cerium, aluminum 3 have very high gamma of 1620, 1620 millijoule per mole per Kelvin square. So what we are, some of the compounds that we study, the free electron theory, the Drude models are not, we cannot use them. What we use is a Landau-Fermi liquid theory. So in the free electron theory, the quantum statistics Fermi-Dirac, if you see, it actually gets modified. At T equal to temperature, it's just like a square step function. Here, it gets modified. In the free electron theory, you have simple electronic mass, but here you have a strong electron-electron interaction. And so think of like you are trying to drag this electron out because it is interacting with all the electron in the surrounding. The interaction is so huge, it becomes like a quasi-particle with very heavy electronic mass. So this is like a quasi-particle with interaction turned on adiabatically. So all the, you can think of like a quantum mechanical perturbation. You have a particle in a box and you have now a new term in your Hamiltonian. So all the physical property, the specific heat, the magnetic susceptibility, resistivity, everything changes. So I will focus on a specific heat. We have high mass. And susceptibility actually diverges logarithmically if we go. And the resistivity usually, which is T square, if it follows Landau-Fermi liquid theory, it is T square. But if we go more and more to the zero Kelvin, it doesn't even follow the T square scattering pattern. So the two important model that we usually follow for such compound is the Kondo model. The simple model is a single impurity Kondo effect. What I mean by single impurity is just you have, metals and they have impurity. So you can think of all this 4F and 5F as a small impurity. And so here you see this blue one. This is, think of this as an impurity spin of 5F compound, and you have conduction electron. What happens is in these compound, if you see at high temperature, they don't interact with each other. But as you go down the temperature, they start interacting with each other, which is seen very beautifully in the resistivity data. For example, again, cerium aluminum 3, as you measure the resistivity and go down the lower temperature, you will see the resistivity is increasing because these two impurities, tin and conduction electron, are not talking to each other. They are incoherently scattered. They are basically in this incoherent scattering. But there comes a Kondo temperature where everything sets in order and there's a coherence and it starts scattering coherently and resistivity starts to drop. This is a very hallmark of Kondo compound. And so this interaction, I will go more in this expression that I have here. I'll talk next in the next slide. So what we see is these compounds, if you have magnetism in these compound, these are unusual magnetism. It's a big term. I'll just call it RKKY, interaction magnetism. So here you see these two spins. These two spins that you see here, they are not like the simple antiferromagnet structure. They are talking through the conduction electron. If you see this quasi-particle thing, they go, they talk, and on this is like sitting on each lattice side. So the second extension of this Kondo model is Kondo lattice system. Basically, your magnetic ion is at regular lattice side, and you have antiferromagnetic arrangement. So J, that you see the strength of the magnetic interaction, when the compound have this long range order, it is RKKY is proportional to J square. And when you tune it, when you apply chemical pressure or hydrostatic pressure and bring down this magnetic order temperature to zero Kelvin, you see Kondo compound. You see that the Kondo scale varies as exponential minus 1 by J. They are two different functions, so they behave differently. And it is interesting to see the competition. So I will show it here in this graph that you have T on y-axis and strength of interaction on the x-axis. So you start, say, I'll show one example compound that I have studied. So RKKY interaction, you have some magnetic order, which is going as J square, the blue curve. And as you are changing the strength of interaction, JC, using magnetic field, doping or doping chemical pressure or hydrostatic pressure, you can tune this magnetic order to come down to zero. You completely suppress it. And because of quantum fluctuation in this area, you will see superconductivity. My compound didn't show. Or sometimes you will see even breakdown of Landau's Fermi liquid theory. The typical hallmark is measuring all those physical properties, and you will see they will also even deviate from Landau Fermi liquid theory. And you see this graph, the purple graph, that is TK, the Kondo temperature that plays. You can see that in this region, Kondo energy is more dominant than the RKKY. So I've just listed these things, this how RKKY and Kondo effect interplay by tuning these parameters. So again, I'll just summarize quickly. Resistivity in Landau is going T square, but if it breaks, even if you go more towards the low temperature side and land, if you have quantum critical point, like because of this quantum fluctuation, you will see breakdown of this T square law, and you will see non-T square behavior. Simple gamma T plus beta T cube will show a deviation here, a logarithmic divergence. Similarly, magnetic susceptibility, which is just proportional to the quasi-particle mass, you will see a logarithmic divergence. So what I'm pointing all these things is that this is a very new exotic ground states we are seeing because of the quantum critical point. Basically, you are moving this ordering temperature at zero Kelvin, which means there is no thermal vibration, it is all quantum fluctuation. And the normal theory that we have, even up to the Landau-Fermi liquid theory, we cannot apply that. All theory breaks down. It's kind of like a black hole of material science, that everything kind of like where time diverges here, our all the physical properties are diverging because you're tuning them through, I wouldn't say through, you're tuning them to T equal to zero Kelvin. So we don't have right now any theory for this strong correlation phenomena. So we work with theorists to develop a theoretical model for this. And the application is really huge in spintronics, in colossal magnetoresistance, in 1D and 2D kind of strong correlated electrometal, like topological insulator and all that, and Luttinger liquids. So I worked on uranium, copper, aluminum series. This is 4 plus aluminum 8 minus X series. And as you keep removing aluminum, you add more copper on its side. So this is the chemical structure of this compound. It crystallizes in tetragonal thorium manganese 12 structure. I'll come to this phase diagram again. But I'll come in the next slide and show you how we have tuned it to zero Kelvin. And before I go there, I'm routinely saying zero Kelvin. So we have to use cryostats. And these cryostats are little advanced. We use dilution refrigerator mostly, or helium-3 refrigerator. Helium-3 refrigerator can go up to 300 millikelvin. I'm just saying for the undergraduate students, I know faculties are aware of it, but you know, for students, this is something new. And dilution refrigerator, you can easily go up to 20 millikelvin. So we use both of those fridges. And here, if you see, I have resistivity data here. So my compound copper 4 plus X, aluminum 8 minus X, with X equal to 0 composition, it has some long range antiferromagnetic order, like RKKY interaction that I showed. It has this kink here that you see. And as you increase the X, you can see the kink starts to move towards the low temperature. So I'm using a chemical pressure to suppress this magnetic order towards 0 Kelvin. So I found that in this compound, I have a quantum critical point at X, critical X of 1.15. And so these are the same thing that I talked about in the theory, which is happening in my compound. And after this critical point, the Kondo energy scale becomes dominant, and you see this peak-like structure. Do you see that Kondo temperature? It scatters incoherently, and then it goes back low on the lower temperature side and starts decreasing in value. So here I'm just showing the critical X compound. If you see the low temperature data, it doesn't fit in T square, rho naught plus AT square. That is not we are not able to fit that. So it is also breaking. That is why it is the land of Fermi liquid theory cannot explain this compound. We need new kind of theory for these non-Fermi liquid compounds. So far we call it just non-Fermi liquid compound. These are some specific heat measurements that I did. And if you see the specific heat measurement for X, I'm doing for only for the Kondo compound, starting from the critical value 1.15. And so starting from this purple one, it is kind of hidden here. I don't have too much data. Maybe my fridge wasn't working. So I have like up to 1.8 Kelvin. And then you see this green, red, and then blue, and the black data at the higher X, they all are increasing in gamma that I was talking. And actually, they're also logarithmically, if you plot on the logarithmic scale, actually, it's a linear function. So you can see it is a diverging at very, very low temperature. So in my phase diagram, I will just reiterate, this compound has a long range order somewhere at 30, and it is suppressed. This Neel temperature is suppressed to zero at critical 1.15 using chemical pressure in this compound. And in this region, the critical region, we see breakdown of even Landau Fermi liquid theory. That's what I just want to point out. Now I will change gear and go to the second compound, uranium cadmium 11. That compound is also a heavy fermion compound, have a long range antiferromagnetic order at somewhere at 5 Kelvin. And in this compound, I have used pressure. I will skip the two slides of my pressure slides, because KK has extensively talked about. So earlier I was using in my lab, I'll just point out this second thing. Second slide something. In my lab, I was using this piston cylinder pressure cell. And in the piston cylinder, it's basically simple piston. You press the piston, you have a cylinder, you place your sample with the medium and you press it. But we are limited. You cannot press it more without breaking. So you can go up to 3 gigapascal. But this new technique of diamond anvil pressure cell, actually it was started by geophysicists because they want to go up to the pressure of the core of the earth, that is 300 gigapascal, and they are able to achieve it. So we started using that technique in our lab, and a lot of condensed matter physicists are using it now. The severe constraint that we have is the work area is really small because pressure is force by area. If you want more force, more pressure, you have to reduce the area. So we are working on a diamond culet, which is 300 micrometer, and by putting all the arrangement of gasket and everything, you are working something in 70 micrometer space. So it's really challenging to work, and it's very straining to your eyes. But once you get the data, it is worth publishing and worth sharing, and you do get new physics. You get to see new physics here. So I'll skip all this slide, and I'll just go to the technique that I used for the second compound. So I used a spectroscopy technique called X-ray absorption near edge spectroscopy, and a little advanced version of it's called resonant inelastic X-ray spectroscopy. Resonant inelastic X-ray spectroscopy has two parts. I'll come to that. So let's see first in the near edge spectroscopy. What I do is, as KK said, this technique is also a spectroscopy probe, and it can really probe whatever element you want. It is charge specific, it is element specific, it is orbital specific, so you have so much of liberty. So for my uranium, I wanted to probe the uranium compound, so I worked at uranium L3H. You have different L3H for different compound from X-ray data, you can find out. So uranium L3H is at 17.1 kilo electron volt. So that's a good thing. The downside is that as you go higher in the periodic table, the energy increases. The moment you knock out an electron from the core, knock out the 2p core electron and create a core hole, the higher the energy, you have internal lifetime broadening. The more the energy, the broadening is more. So not only you are limited by the limitation of the resolution of your spectrometer, but there is an internal broadening in your system, and that puts a constraint on it. So I haven't shown yet a YB compound. So in the YB compound, we can resolve all the things because it is lower in energy. It is 13 kilo electron volt. The YB L3H is at 13 kilo electron volt. Uranium, you jump to 17 kilo electron volt, and there are some downsizes. I'll come to that. So I worked at that edge. We basically knock out a 2p3x2 core hole, and we shoot it up to 60, above 60 level, and we play with this core hole. Basically, here if you see this schematic of the arrangement of the equipment, because we are working with one single wavelength, we have a mono, you have a synchrotron source. All these experiments, by the way, are done at synchrotron source. In India, we have Indus 2 Indus 2 in Indore. And if you, I'm encouraging the students, I like to catch the attention of students. If you happen to be in Indore, please go and take a tour of this Indus 2. And I think it is worth visiting. So we have synchrotron source, you have polychromatic X-rays coming, and you use monochromator to choose whatever wavelength you want. So we have a 17.1 around that energy, the X-ray beam coming, and it shoots the sample. Now you may ask, why in the world I want to go to synchrotron? Why can't I do it in the lab? As KK said, that we are limited by the target. And you said how much high you can go with molybdenum?
17.
And we also work with plutonium, which is little more higher. But even if you go up to 17, you have to go through the diamond. All our samples are encased in two diamond, pair of diamond. So you have to go through the diamond, and you need huge flux for that. We have limitation on flux in the laboratory setup. So that's the advantage you have. You save huge amount of time. I can take one spectra in 20 minutes. If you do in lab, you will be just doing it for 2-3 days. So you have monochromatic X-ray beam going, and it hits the sample, and basically you just compare your incident to the transmitted beam and see what is absorbed, and you plot the absorption coefficient. You plot the absorption coefficient as a function of edge energy in and around plus or minus 20 electron volt. And you can see, just I want to point out, you see that initially there is no jump, and as soon as it comes to the edge energy, you see a huge absorption. And then we play with the pressure and all that. The second setup is for PFY XAS and RXCS. Sorry, it's very mouthful. Together, it's called resonant inelastic X-ray spectroscopy. This is similar to Zane's, but what we are doing is instead of measuring the primary channel, once you knock out the 2p electron, we don't measure the primary channel. We measure, once you create a hole, you know, there are severe decay, several decay channels, and we measure the secondary decay channel in this case, that is uranium L-alpha-1 fluorescence line, which is at 13.614 kilo electron volt. So the reason for doing is that I can remove the internal core hole broadening and gain a little bit on my resolution and have more clear spectra. So that is the point, that is the reason for doing. And this can be done in two ways. So you again shoot the electron at 17.1 kV and keep measuring the L-alpha-1 fluorescence line by varying the L3 absorption edge. All you can do is choose one energy for the L3 absorption edge, little above the edge, and go one by one throughout that energy range and make it like a 2D scan. Take one energy and then measure up and down L-alpha-1 fluorescence line. So it's like a 2D plot you are making, and I will show you one plot. So here also we have a monochromator. It goes through the mirrors, KB mirrors, and then it goes through the sample, and we are measuring the fluorescence line is always 90 degree to the incident beam. Sorry, this is a projected view. So this one is 90 degree. Here you have a silicon analyzer that fluorescence lines it measure, and you have a detector that does some single, it's a single crystal. Basically, there is X-ray diffraction that goes back to detector, and it calibrates the 2 theta to the energy position, so you know which energy you are storing in detector. So you can do the 2D scan. And here I already mentioned about all the advantages of this new technique. So I'll come to the data now. So what we did, this is again, I have on the left-hand side, I have Zane's data of various uranium compounds that we have studied. So what we did is we took various uranium compound and compared it to alpha uranium. So this alpha uranium is at the position zero, and these are the shift in the peak of the spectra. You saw that a spectra, resonance spectra, that one, it's called white line, and this delta E alpha is the shift in the white line. So you take a reference compound with the same setup of the spectrometer, and then you measure all these compound and see how much it is shifted from alpha uranium. The reason I take alpha uranium, because alpha uranium is an itinerant system. So I'm seeing how much my system is deviating from alpha uranium. So, and here on the y-axis, I have plotted the gamma of the specific heat, that physical property. I'm trying to correlate both data. And if you see, they both are, this is like a straight line. There is a one-to-one correlation. High gamma means high localized orbital, more atomic-like orbital. And high shift means high, more same thing. It is more atomic-like nature of the 5F orbital. Now you see that all these compounds have different dopant. So the 5F wave function is showing different variation of localization, varying degree of localization is seen. So you see all these dots, it shows different shifts. So this technique is really amazing, because this shift delta E alpha is a direct measurement of the degree of delocalization of the 5F orbital that we can do it. And why it is? Because when you knock out the electron, you have a core hole, and you can, because you have a core hole, you will have Coulomb interaction of the core hole with the outgoing photoelectron. And then because of the Coulomb interaction, your core hole is, whether it is localized or delocalized. For example, if it is localized, it will better screen the whole atom, right? Whole thing. So it will not interact so much. But if it is localized, you will see more Coulomb interaction. So now you can play with this and understand very directly how is the nature of your 5F orbital in this compound. Now you may ask why I'm so interested is because as you go on the heavy metal side, the electronic configuration is not so straight and it is not so easy to measure, and you need that data to put in the theoretical model. So I use this technique for these all these compounds. This is not just done by me. This data is taken at Stanford Linear Accelerator in Lawrence Berkeley National Lab with my collaborator Corwin Booth. And based on these data, we decided to study this dot, UCD11, which is the highest localized in this group. This UCD11 has a cubic, it's a barium HE11 type cubic structure. And the interesting thing about this compound is it has very high shift in the high gamma and very high shift in the white line. And also another thing interesting, it has high UU distance, 6.56 angstrom. This is the low, so this is the most localized compound that we have. So we did some RxCS 2D plot of this data, and these are all just the data analysis on this side. Usually this 2D plot that I'm showing here, ytterbium compounds, I don't know if you have seen ytterbium and europium compounds, samarium compound. They sometimes, most of them, some maybe not all, but majority of them, they show intermediate valence. They have two valences. And as I talked about, the resolution is little better because it is above the periodic table. You can literally see the division of different 4F configuration. In our case, we have three configurations. So in 5F1, we have 7%. 5F2, we have 15%, and 5F3 configuration, we have 78%. So it's not a very straightforward configuration. In this case, we did a computational modeling to find out this configuration. But in 4F compound, it is very easy. You can just do a simple using even Excel sheet. You can, and if you know some basic computer programming in C++ or Python, you can analyze the data. But this one is a little bit trickier. And because the it is not so straightforward, it is not split is not so obvious. So you have to play with it. So this is the configuration that we found. It is interesting to note that the alpha uranium is in pure 5F3 configuration. There's another compound called uranium PD2 aluminum 3, where they have some compound in some compound are localized, some are in itinerant. So they have come up with a theory called a dual model, which is popular, but it is not applicable to all compounds. So this is what we found in our compound. And this is the PFY XAS data. This is the fluorescence data, X-ray absorption data, but in the fluorescence yield mode. And we took this data under very high pressure, highest pressure up to 28.2 GPa. So starting from zero, you can see as we apply pressure, the data, the white line is shifting towards the other side. So the compound is becoming more delocalized. And also the amplitude is going down and the full width half maxima of the profile is increasing. So this is the rate and rate of change of the shift in the white line with respect to pressure. And you can see it's a linear increase with 0.15 electron volt per GPa. And I found in literature, some of the, we work with the radiochemistry department in University of Nevada. All this data, by the way, it is taken at our Argonne National Lab, has advanced photon source synchrotron. And our university provides funding to the one of the high pressure beam lines. So we go with the radiochemistry department. And in the radiochemistry, they study all these techniques that I'm talking is useful not just for physics, but it is used a lot in pharmacy and biophysics and radiochemistry people. They used it a lot. Actually, they use it more than us. So if you see these two compounds, uranium F4 and uranium Cl3, the shift in this white line from 0 to 28 GPa is 4.1 electron, which is a lot of energy, which means that you have almost moved one electron. Just it may not be the same in our case because our 5F configuration is different, but I just want to point out that that is quite a lot of pressure. As KK said, one atmosphere is 10,000 times of the atmospheric pressure. You can see we need so much high pressure to break that strong correlation to move the electron. The shift is almost change in one oxidation state from going from UF4 to UCl3. This is just the change in full width half maxima, and it increases by 3.8 electron volt going from lowest to high pressure, ambient to high pressure. So now what my next part is now to use this, the information that we have found about the 5F configuration and the shift in the white line. Now we can use this information in our theoretical modeling. So our next aim is to use this compound as a prototype to study other uranium compounds that, you know, show such behavior and do a theoretical modeling. And we will see how it goes. Maybe we'll have a theory, maybe we not, but the next step is now to, this will become a, like a prototype compound to test a lot of theoretical models because we have so many good information on this compound. So I will quickly summarize. I talked about two different compounds, but they are same 5F uranium compound. They both are heavy fermion. In one compound, I use chemical pressure. So in that, I have to keep in mind, it's not such a clean pressure parameter. In the other one, I used hydrostatic pressure. It is very clean. No disorder is introduced. In the first compound, I used specific heat to understand the heavy fermion phenomena, and I connected that direct physical property measurement of specific heat to my the spectroscopy data, that is specifically the white line shift, and connected how those two are one-to-one correlated, and have done some groundwork for the next step to do theoretical modeling for this compound to serve it as a prototype for other localized uranium compound. Thank you for your attention, and I'm open for questions.
Hello.
Dr. Emmanuel?
Yeah, I'm here. So, is there anybody to ask some questions? Participants? You can ask any questions.
If there are students, I would like to have questions from students more. Not that.
No, most of them are lecturers, you know, that's why.
There is. Maybe PhD students, I thought.
Not like this. All are. Degree college lecturers.
No, I do welcome all, but as a teacher, my focus goes there more.
Yeah, like that. So, is there anybody? Okay. So, madam, can you withdraw your share screen?
Yeah, sure.
Stop
sure.
Share.
1 minute.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, any more questions from any more participant? Or madam is there to clarify your doubts. But anyway, both Karunakar and Madam Farzana has given a wonderful lecture. And definitely it is an enlightenment in the field of material science. And most of our participants may enjoy their lecture. So with this, we are concluding today's session, and I want to thank both Karunakar and Mrs. Karunakar for giving your valuable lectures and spending more time with Sir CRD Autonomous College. And we are very grateful to you, both of you. Thank you very much once again. And I will contact you later, sir. And tomorrow we are going to have a very live lectures from our old student, Professor Jayaprakash Garu, and also Dr. Tarun Dolla from Guwahati. So please make a note, after this session, we are sending the feedback form. If still any participant is not registered, please make your registration now itself, and tomorrow We will meet by 10:30 a.m. Today afternoon, we are scheduling the meeting and we will send the link to all of the participants. So tell your friends, friends and colleagues also, as tomorrow's sessions are going to be very interesting. So therefore, until then, take care of yourself, stay home and safe home, and good afternoon to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having us. Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Yeah. Bye. Swarup? Swarup, are you there? Swarup?
Sir, Japan, sir.
Ah, yes. Sir. Please leave the, end the program.
Okay,
thank you very much for all of you.
Okay, sir.
Okay.